योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचाम् मलम् शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन चोपाकरोत्तम् प्रवरम् मुनीनाम् पतञ्जलिम् प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि आबाहु पुरुषाकारम् शङ्खचक्रासिधारिणम् सहस्रशिरसं श्वेतं प्रणमामि पतञ्जलिम् गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः हरि ओम। सो इन द प्रीवियस सेशन वी फर्स्ट लुक्ड एट सूत्र 2.14 विच वाज ते लाद परिताप फलाः पुण्यापुण्य हेतुत्वात्। Where essentially it was said that the jati, ayu, bhoga, the phala, the fruits of action can either be of the nature of lada, which is pleasure and delight, or paritapa, which is sorrow and torment, depending on whether they are caused by punya, which is meritorious deeds, or papa, which is the opposite, the sort of the bad deeds. So that was somewhat straightforward, but then Vyasa made a statement which said that विषय सुख कालेपि दुःखम् अस्ति एव प्रतिकूलात्मकं योगिनः, which means even during times of pleasure for the yogi there is sorrow and of the nature of being unfavorable. And then the question came up, well, how does this make sense? कथं तत् उपपद्यते? How is this appropriate that even during times of happiness and pleasure, the yogi sees dukkha and sorrow? And why is that? And in answer to that, we started looking at Sutra 2.15, which said, Parinama tapa samskara dukkhaihi gunavritti virodaccha dukkhameva sarvam vivekinaha. So for the viveki or the yogi who has discrimination or discernment, it says because of parinama tapa and samskara dukkha, and we'll see what the meaning is. We saw a little bit last time as well. And gunavritti virodat dukkhameva sarvam. So now that question which came up as in 2.14 will be answered in detail in 2.15. And we already looked at a beginning where the Vyasa explained how in times of pleasure there is attachment and it gives rise to ragaja karmashayaha, the karmashaya that is born out of desire. Similarly, he also gave the situation where it can give rise to dveshaja karmashayaha, mohaja karmashayaha, and also due to attachment there is this desire to possess, to take, and this is a kind of himsa which gives rise to sharira karmashayaha as well. So this is something we looked at last time, so we will not repeat. And then Vyasa proceeded to define the sukha and dukkha in question, which is mostly the sensory sukha and the sensory dukkha. So he said, Ya bhogeshu indriyanam trupte rupashantihi tat sukham, which we have described, the meaning has been described last time. Ya laulyat anupashantihi tat dukham. So the uneasiness, the fickleness, the unsteadiness and excessive passion of the senses, because it desires are not met, the senses are not meeting their objects, that is dukkham. So here it is a sort of a limited and worldly meaning of sukha and dukkha that is being considered, but also very nicely those have been defined, and those have been defined with correspondence to indriyas, the senses, and their tendency to go towards their objects. So that is a very clear definition given by Vyasa. And then Vyasa made a statement, which again we saw last time. Nacha indriyanam bhogabhyasena vaitrushnyam kartum shakyam. So for example, one might say that, okay, indriyas are the cause of the problem. They seem to want their objects of senses, which means whatever it is, रूप रस गंध देयर फेवरेट थिंग फॉर ईच ऑफ द सेंसेस दे सीम टू वांट दैट इफ दे डोंट गेट दैट दे आर अनईजी एंड दैट लीड्स टू दुख व्हाई नॉट गिव देम व्हाट दे नीड देयर व्यास इज आंसरिंग ही सेज नच इंद्रियाणां भोगाभ्यासेन वैतृष्ण्यं कर्तुं शक्यं भोगाभ्यासः अभ्यास मीन्स पौनपुण्येन करणे डूइंग इट अगेन एंड अगेन सो टू द इंद्रियास इफ वॉट एवर दे नीड इज गिवन अगेन एंड अगेन देन विल देयर डिजायर गो अवे विल दे गेट वैतृष्ण्यम सो व्यास सेज नो इट इज नॉट पॉसिबल सो दैट मैकेनिज्म ऑफ सैटिस्फाइंग द इंद्रियास इट इज ओके इट यू नीड समथिंग लेट मी गिव इट टू यू दैट डजंट वर्क एंड नाउ दैट विल बी एक्सप्लेन्ड So Vyasa says, Kasmat, why? And this is where we stopped last time. So now we continue. So Kasmat, so Vyasa answers, Yataha, Bhoga Vyasam, Anuvivardhante Ragaha, Kaushalani cha Indriyanam, Iti, Tasmat, Anupayaha, Sukhasya Bhoga Vyasaha Iti. So what this means is, Yataha, because, भोगाभ्यासम सो दिस काइंड ऑफ सैटिस्फाइंग द डिजायर्स ऑफ द सेंसेस हैबिचुअली डूइंग इट ओवर एंड ओवर अगेन व्हाट डज इट लीड टू अनुविवर्धन्ते रागाः सो इट इन फैक्ट इट इंक्रीजेस द अटैचमेंट बिकॉज द इंद्रियास फॉलो दैट मोर एंड द डिजायर इन फैक्ट इंक्रीजेस सो नॉट ओनली देर इज नो वैतृष्ण्यम द प्रॉब्लम becomes worse because the desire in fact increases. Kaushalani cha indriyanam. The indriyas get more and more kaushalya or skill in being able to consume those objects. So the not only there is more desire, the ability to get into this kind of consumption and the nature of consuming the objects, whether it is taste, hearing, rupa, rasa, whatever it is, the skill in consuming those things also grows. So kaushalani cha indriyanam iti, tasmat therefore anupayaha. So it is an invalid solution. So it is not a valid way to address the problem. Anupayaha. What is anupayaha? Sukasya bhogabhyasaha. So this approach of giving more and more pleasure. So that this problem and the unsteadiness of indriyas will go away. That does not work. So it is anupayaha sukasya bhogabhyasaha. So this is what Vyasa is saying. And then he makes a very nice analogy. He says, Sa khalu ayam vrishchika vishabhitaha iva ashi visheena dashtaha yaha sukharthi विषयानुवासितः महति दुःखपंके निमग्न इति सो व्यास गिव्स अ वेरी पिक्चरेस्क काइंड ऑफ एनालॉजी ही सेज दिस इज लाइक समवन हु इज अफ्रेड ऑफ द स्कॉर्पियंस पॉइजनस बाइट द स्कॉर्पियंस पॉइजन एंड बीइंग अफ्रेड ऑफ दैट एज दो ही इज नाउ ही गोज एंड गेट्स बिटन विद द स्नेक्स पॉइजन व्हिच इज इवन मोर डेंजरस Because he is afraid of the uneasiness of the senses and then he is in fact giving the senses more and more of what they need and by doing that it is as though he is going because of his afraid of the smaller poison which is the scorpions he is going into the snake's poison which is much more dangerous and mahati dukkha panke nimagnaha so in the mire the mud and mire of sorrow He is getting himself immersed, nimagnaha, by doing this. So this is not only invalid, it is almost foolish that by recognizing that dukkha is a nature of unsteadiness of senses, attempt to satisfy the senses, and that upaya or that approach is completely invalid and counterproductive. And this is illustrated by the nice analogy of being fearful of a scorpion's poison, which is smaller, and ending up with the snake's lethal poisonous bite. So this is what Vyasa is saying.
So the sutra is mentioning that everything is sorrowful for a yogi. by Parinama Dukkha, Tapa Dukkha, Samskara Dukkha and Gunavrutti Virodha. So first he is now explaining Parinama Dukkha. Parinama Dukkha means consequentially painful, effectively painful. The first thing that we must take note of is that there is no need to explain how sorrow is sorrowful. It is not necessary to explain someone as to why sorrow is sorrowful. It is more important to understand how pleasure, delight is having sorrow potential, how it can be sorrow. The first one is Parinama Dukkha. By Parinama Dukkha it is being explained. This is consequential pain. In pleasure consumption, in gratification, in pleasure seeking tendency or nature or process, there is a consequential sorrow. Parinama Dukkha. And there is a simple example is that we all enjoy a party food. Several delicacies are there. And then when we eat all those delicacies and gratify the senses, gratify our passion, there is a discomfort having overeaten because of all the delicacies in front of us. We tend to overeat in such condition when the delicacies are being served. Then there is discomfort, even little discomfort, even after meal has been eaten, sumptuously eaten, there is some discomfort, heaviness. So this is a simple example to understand that there is a consequential, some sort of discomfort in pleasure, in gratification, in pleasure consumptions. And this is a very simple example which all of us experience. Then, when the pleasure objects have been identified, when the pleasure objects are in availability, and therefore we consume, take pleasures out of them, that is called bhoga vyasa. Bhoga means to enjoy. And we start developing our tendency, habituation to go for gratification of the senses. So it should not be taken that if you go on gratifying the senses will be quieted. They are temporarily quieted for a while. Again, they will have their call, and again, they will have their demands, and again, we will have to feed them. So, bhoga abhyasa is no solution to pacify the sense. They'll be temporarily pacified when you give them what they want. However, that is not the means. As a matter of fact, if we start quietening the senses by giving their gratifications, by giving their delights, by serving their delights on their demands, then they start developing skill. And they start developing skill in procuring what they want. Because senses have their tendencies, and they have that tendency to go after their pleasures, seek their pleasures, get their pleasures, demand their pleasures, procure their pleasures, and consume their pleasures. So they start developing skill in this aspect. They will see how to coax the subjective entity, a person there, and make the person do the needful for their gratification. They start developing skill. Now this is like when you cajole your child overtly, excessively, pamper your child. When you pamper your child, the child gets delight and you also get delight because the child is delighted. But we realize that pampered child become a problem. The more you pamper the child, the more it becomes a problem subsequently. So similarly, these sensory desires are like children demanding. And then if you pamper them by offering their objects and giving their pleasures, they will become like pampered child who become problem for lifetime. Therefore, bhoga abhyasa is not the means. Moreover, they will develop the skill as to how to procure their delight and consume their delight. So they start developing skill, and they will be enticing you for satisfaction, their satisfaction. Now, therefore, bhoga abhyasa is not at all a measure to pacify the senses. Then he mentions that how the senses develop laulya, that is, more and more craze to go after their objects and entice the person, that subjective entity, to go after seeking the objects and offer the objects. Now, offering the objects to senses is like offering fuel into fire. If you go on putting offer the fuel into fire, the fire is going to blaze forth more and more. Similarly, the desire of the senses is like fire, and the more you offer the objects into the fire of the sense, the desire of the senses, the more and more that fire for desire will blaze forth. So it is like offering the fuel into senses when the sensory desires are satisfied. Therefore, that is not the solution to have peace of mind, because the senses will go on demanding more often and more often, and more of pleasures. So there'll be incremental desires in the senses. Therefore, that bhogabhyasa is not at all the measure. So this is the parinama dukkha. So while we consume the pleasures, it's a pleasure. It's a pleasurable time. It's a pleasure time. We see get pleasure because senses, our senses get pleasure. We are also happy. But consequently, or effectively, there is a sorrow potential, that the senses will become like pampered child and they will become problem to parents. So that's why the good parents regulate their child. They don't give up. Desire of the child is not satisfied, they take care. So they reform the child, and then the child is not a problem. But when the child is pampered over and over and over and again, then it becomes a problem, a lifelong problem. So gratification of the senses is not the means. It gives very temporary happiness and delight. However, it is just momentary. Soon they will have their calls for gratification. Therefore, that is the parinama dukkha. There is effective sorrow in delight. Like overeating, there is a sorrow. Or habituation, then comes sorrow. We get habituated to that, and then we get the sorrow. So, in way, these are the ways why pleasure-seeking tendency has potential sorrow in it. It has a problem in it, and that will be surfacing sooner or later. That's why that's parinama dukkha. Even in pleasure, there is a parinama dukkha. Needless to tell you that there is sorrow in sorrow. But in sukha, it has to be pointed out that there is sorrow. That is parinama dukkha. That's the first kind of dukkha which Patanjali has mentioned. Okay.
So Vyasa concludes this section saying, Esha parinama dukkata nama pratikula sukhavasthayam api yoginameva klishnati. He says, this is parinama dukkha. This is the parinama dukkata. And sukhavasthayam api, even in times of pleasure, it troubles. But whom? Yoginam eva. So again, he is making it clear. Only to, this is seen as a problem only to the yogi who understands this, the true nature of things. And a layman who is at the moment enjoying his pleasures does not see it as dukkha. So there is the wisdom aspect being brought about in connection with the yogi. So Vyasa moves on now. Because
one more thing. one more thing before you go to Tapa Dukkata. See, in Parinama Dukkha, suppose when there is a desire-seeking tendency and we try to obstruct it, because we know it is going to be painful. If we don't give the satisfaction and gratification, don't get gratified in sensory objects, sensory consumption, we will not be happy. We won't be happy. And therefore, we try to take measure to avoid this kind of sorrow or discomfort or unhappiness. And by what measure we take, we try to give some satisfaction. So we try to avoid a magnitude of sorrow, because there is a sorrow in not giving gratification or not having getting gratified. So there is definitely a discomfort, some kind of pain, but this is the magnitude of it is very low, and we depart from there and take a measure which is like departing from a scorpion bite. We are falling into the jaws of a snake. So which is greater fatality? There is low magnitude sorrow in just avoiding that discomfort by not gratifying, not getting gratified. So we avoid that petty sorrow, and our measure is such that we fall into jaws of perhaps python or a huge poisonous snake. So that's how our worldly measures are. Therefore, we need wisdom to take measures. Okay.
Yeah. In another text, the Parinama Dukkata is concisely defined as Vishayanam Bhoge Trishna Abhivruddhi Parinamaha. So by consuming the objects of the senses, by experiencing, by the bhoga, the increase of trishna, desire, is parinama, parinama dukkha. Now, atha ka tapa dukkata? What is this tapa dukkata? Sarvasya dveshanu viddha chetana 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 sadhana dhinaha tapanu bhavaha iti. So this is, the tapa dukkha is more the regular dukkha that we would typically see. He says, sarvasya tapa anubhavaha. Everybody experiences some kind of tapa or torment, from where dveshana viddha chetana chetana sadhana adhinaha. So whoever is adhina, in some sense dependent on what? Deshanu viddha chetana chetana sadhana means on things or instruments, whether sentient or insentient. Sentient means people, say friends, relatives, wife, son, daughter, etc. Achetana means things, so the vehicle, house, and everything else. Now, dveshanu viddha, so all of them in places. There is this pervading of dvesha in there, because whenever it is in the, of the nature of obstructing the sukha, there is a dvesha that gets generated, and the chetana achetana frequently are of that nature, where the sukha or the worldly sukha, as mentioned earlier, gets obstructed. So there is this constant experiencing of tapa. So that is the tapa anubhavaha. Tatra asti dveshajaha karmashayaha. So what that gives rise to is dveshaja karmashaya. So the karmashaya is problematic. The dveshaja karmashaya, or the karmashaya coming up out of torment or hatred or say unhappiness, is definitely a problematic karmashaya. So tatra asti dveshaja karmashaya. Sukha sadhanani. So now what happens in this case? So this is nicely said here. Sukha sadhanani cha prarthayamanaha kayena vacha manasa cha parispandate. So this person who is experiences this kind of a tapa, why? Because one of his things, sentient or insentient, is causing him problems or preventing him from getting his worldly sukha. What does he do? Sukha sadhanani cha prarthayamanaha, praying for, longing for what? Sukha sadhanani, the objects that give him pleasure. And how? Kayena vacha manasa. So kaya means body, vak means speech, Manasa means mind. So kayena, by the body, vacha, by the vak, by the speech, manasa, by the mind. So in all ways, he is longing for his sukha sadhana and parispandate. So it is as though all of them are throbbing. There is no ease. There is no comfort. There is no relaxation. It is throbbing and longing for the sukha sadhana. So that is the tapa dukkata. Nicely, picturesquely described here. Tataha param anugrinnati upahanti chaiti paranugraha peeda abhyam dharma dharmau upachinoti. So what does he do? Because he is now longing and throbbing from his mind, body, speech and everything, to the other he gratifies or causes problems. Right? He may gratify, flatter to get his sukha sadhana, or he may cause problems, scold, yell and so on to get his sukha sadhana. And by this, para anugraha, by favoring the other, or by parapida, causing problem to the other, dharma adharma, so both his dharma and adharma, depending on what he did to get his sukha sadhana. So when a person wants something, there are different ways to attain it. One is by doing deeds that from a worldly sense are meritorious, by helping someone and getting a favor and so on, or are problematic by tormenting someone and getting what he needs. In both cases, he is gathering, upachinoti, means heaping up. He is gathering, collecting what dharma and adharma, dharma, 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 upachinoti. So essentially, whatever with tapa dukkha, whichever way he behaves in consequence, the karmashaya is going to grow, whether it is dharma or adharma. So he collects dharma and adharma. Sakarmashaya lobhat mohaccha bhavati ityesha tapadukkatochyate. Means this karmashaya being built out of lobha and moha. Because even if he ends up doing punya and getting dharma, the root of it here is his longing for sukha sadhana. So the karmashaya is being built up or heaped up. Upachinoti means being heaped up through lobha, greed, right? Longing, desire, and moha, delusion. So through lobha and moha, the karmashaya is being built, and therefore, he says, this is known as tapa dukkata. So here ends Vyasa's description of the second one. We had seen parinama dukkha, now we just saw tapa dukkha.
So the parinama dukkha develops ragaja karmashaya and tapa dukkha develops deshaja karmashaya, according to Vyasa. Now, what is this tapa dukkha? Tapa dukkha is a kind of sorrow or pain by way of anxiety, worry. Now, where do you get this worry and anxiety? Why do you have and where do you have worry and anxiety? It is, you have this attachment to the chetana, chetana, sadhana, sentient, insentient instruments which give you pleasure. Like your beloved will give you pleasure, your wife, husband, etc., children, they give you pleasure, which are sentient instruments which give pleasures. And then there are insentient instruments which give pleasure, such as property, house, car, vehicle, jewelry, ornaments, etc., money, gold and silver. So these are insentient things which also give pleasure to us. Now, with regards to them, there is always a worry and anxiety. Like in case of money, we know money gives pleasure, but then money gives also worry. Why? Because we are afraid that the money might depreciate, get dwindled. So it is always a cause of anxiety that my money should not dwindle, my money should not depreciate, my money should not be lost. I must preserve my money. So there is anxiety to preserve the money. So in case of insentient objects which give pleasures, there is worry and anxiety that I might lose it. I got wonderful car, but the car might go old and therefore I will lose it. So in sentient things, we always make provisions and we see that we will preserve it. We will be able, we will be preserving it, and we have to do so many things to preserve those things because they give us pleasures. Say similarly, there is case of sentient things, we have to take care of all those people, say that they are not, they don't become unhappy, they don't go away, they don't get away from us, and they are not unhappy with us, and therefore we will have to do some appeasement. So there will be exercising appeasement policy in respect to these sentient pleasure giving objects. And they also create anxiety, worry, as I just now said, that they may be unfavorable to us. So that should not happen, because if they become unfavorable, we will not get life, we will not get happiness. So we try to do so many things in order to keep them happy so that they will continue to give happiness to us. And therefore, there is anxiety. Like a family holder has always anxiety with regards to family, because he has to take care of the family and he has to take care of the well-being of the family. There is worry, anxiety. So that is a kind of, the tapadukha is of the kind of worry, anxiety in a big way. There is a wonderful illustration given by a mystic poet commentator on Yoga Sutras. He characterizes human mind. See, if there is a lot of green grass for cattle, they are happy and they eat the grass as much as they want. But once they have sumptuously eaten, they turn their backs and walk away. They will not think of carrying some green grass over their backs for tomorrow. They don't bother about tomorrow. They don't have worry of tomorrow. Some humans don't have worry of tomorrow. Human beings have worry, anxiety, etc. of tomorrow. So the bull or cow will not carry any green grass over the back for the next meal or for tomorrow. Whereas we human beings, we have a different nature. If somebody gives wonderful delicacy to us in a party, we will say, okay, do you have some extra? Okay, can I carry it home? Will you give me it in a container so that I can enjoy it in the evening or I will say tomorrow morning or tomorrow? So I can later, because when we have the pleasure, we want the pleasure to be continued. Day after day after day, we want the pleasure to be continued. That is not the case of subhumans. You give them a wonderful party, they will not say, what about tomorrow? They will not be worrying about, they will not say, pack me something, I will carry home and preserve it and I will eat it later. But human psyche is unique. It always has that question mark, worry, anxiety for tomorrow. What tomorrow? I got today wonderful meals, but what about tomorrow? So can I make provision? Can I ask my host to pack me something so that I can carry and I can still enjoy tomorrow? So this is a kind of worry, anxiety, which is typical to human psyche. The subhumans don't have worry and anxiety of the morrow. So they don't have this kind of dukkha, tapa dukkha. What about tomorrow? What about later? So human beings have this. If the pleasure is coming, what about later? Will I get this continued? Then I will have to do some provisions to see that I preserve that the pleasure-giving instrument, take care of it. So there is selfishness behind taking care of these instruments, chetana, chetana, living sentient, insentient, because we want pleasure for a longer time. We want the pleasure continued tomorrow, day after, and day after, etc., etc., and for entire life. Therefore, we have this anxiety kind of dukkha. That's why very apt nomenclature, tapa. That's the kind of anxiety and worry. So this is with regards to, this is pointing out that aspect, that factor, which is typical to human psyche, not to subhuman psyche. They just live in present. They don't have question mark of tomorrow. they have question mark on tomorrow. And that creates a kind of sorrow, dukkha, that is tapa dukkha. Then, when there are pleasure-giving instruments, sentient, we also develop desha potential, because somebody might be antagonizing those. The instruments which give us pleasure, there are some other things, some other people who antagonize it. So they become our aliens. And therefore, we will develop ragaja karmashaya, because we have to take care to see that we go on getting continuous pleasure out of our instruments. And therefore, we will have hawk's eyes on if anyone is going to obstruct our instrument. Is anyone going to be lifting our instruments away from us or weaning our instruments away from us? And therefore, we might lose it. So we also have this hawk's eyes on these alien forces who might prevent our pleasures day after day after day after day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, decade after decade. And therefore, we develop this aversion kind of thing. And therefore, we have hawk's eyes. So therefore, dveshaja karmashaya comes out of it. So in case of sentient, insentient instruments, we will be having this kind of vigilance. Is there anybody antagonizing our pleasure, this kind of pleasure, that kind of pleasure, which comes from this instrument and that instrument? And therefore, we will identify our the aliens. Now, if you identify your aliens, you are never at happiness, in happiness. Because aliens always are problematic. They always will eclipse your happiness. So see, this is there. For some humans, they don't have this. They don't identify these aliens because they don't have question mark of tomorrow. We have this future. The future is quite an agonizing factor for human psyche and not to subhuman psyche. And there's a typical kind of sorrow which comes out of, even during pleasure consumption. While you are consuming pleasure, will I have this tomorrow? Will I have this continuously? So we don't enjoy that pleasure even that time, because we think of later point in time, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, etc. I will not be having this tomorrow. So we are unnecessarily sorrow for tomorrow, which is in futuristic realm. So the problem of future for humankind is a kind of tapa dukkha. So that also gives worry, anxiety, and it creates more and more dveshaja karmashaya. We'll identify our aliens, our enemies, our foes, our antagonizers. Naturally, we will take some steps. So our life is tainted with some sort of sorrow potential, actual sorrow potential, sorrow, etc. That's the tapa dukkha to mankind. Okay.
Yeah, the tapa dukkha is again succinctly described in another text. It says, bhoga paripanthini dvesha stapaha. So in the path of bhoga, the dvesha that gets generated is tapa. Now we move on with the Vyasa's Bhashya. So Vyasa asks, ka punaha samskara dukkata? So he is now beginning to describe the samskara dukkha. Sukhanubhavat sukha samskarashayah dukkhanubhavadapi dukkha samskarashayah iti evam karmabhyo vipake anubhuyamane sukhe dukkheva punaha karmashaya prachaya iti. So the samskara dukkhata is about samskaras getting generated. Samskaras are often translated as latent impressions of the mind. So sukhanubhavat, when pleasures are experienced, sukha samskarashayah, so the collection of sukha samskaras get deposited in the mind, the chitta. Dukkhanubhavadapi, on experiencing sorrow also, दुख संस्कार आशय एवं इन दिस मैनर कर्मभ्या विपाके अनुभूयमाने सुखे दुखे वा पुनः कर्माशय प्रचय इति. सो एज ड्यू टू द कर्म द फ्रूट्स आर एक्सपीरियंस्ड वेदर सुख और दुख अगेन द कर्माशय कीप्स ऑन ग्रोइंग. सो इफ यू रिमेंबर वी हैड सीन एट द वेरी बिगिनिंग ऑफ द फर्स्ट चैप्टर where we had said vritti samskara chakram anishama pravartate. So the vritti leads to samskara, the samskara leads to a similar vritti of the same nature. So this is also somewhat related to smriti and tendency. So there is a memory and a tendency or a vasana due to the samskara that got deposited. So when sukha is experienced, the corresponding samskara gets deposited. That will again lead to similar pratyaya in the mind, which will lead to certain behavior, looking for that sukha, which will again cause karma to be done, which will then lead to an effect of the karma, which again will be of the nature of sukha or dukkha, and this continues forever. Similarly, if it is a dukkha samskara, that will again lead to the vritti and the smriti in the mind about the dukkha, then there will be karma to avoid a dukkha of that nature. That karma will again lead to, depending on the nature of the karma, whether it is dharma or adharma, it will again lead to sukha and dukkha, which will again lead to samskara, and so on. This cycle goes on and on. So this is the samskara dukkhata. Again, who sees all this? Only the yogi is able to notice all this. So the Vyasa continues. He says, evam idam अनादि दुःख स्रोतः विप्रसृतं योगिनम् एव प्रतिकूलात्मकत्वात् उद्वेजयति. उद्वेजयति means causes some sort agitation.
Agitation,
yes. So this causes agitation only to the yogi, because he sees that this is pratikulatmakam, this is problematic. What? This anadi dukkha srotaha, the flow of dukkha, of parinama, tapa, samskara and so on, which is anadi, without beginning, and it keeps on flowing. Only the yogi notices this, and it agitates only the yogi. So the essence of this, all of this, and we will continue the commentary, but the thing to notice, it is not to be understood as, oh, the yogi is always sad. So that is not what is being said here. Yogi is able to see the true nature of things, and he has the wisdom to realize the true nature, and he does, as the wave of happiness and sorrow goes, he is not tossed around on the waves like a normal lay person is. And therefore you will see, say in the Bhagavad Gita, you see dukkheshu anudvigna manaha sukheshu विगत स्पृह वीतराग भय क्रोध स्थित धीर मुनिरुच्यते. सो हियर अ योगी इज बीइंग डिस्क्राइब्ड स्थित प्रज्ञ स्थित धीहि मुनि ऑफ अ स्थित प्रज्ञ नेचर. ही सेज दुखेषु अनुद्विग्न मनः, ड्यूरिंग दुख द माइंड इज नॉट एजिटेटेड. सुखेषु विगत स्पृह, ड्यूरिंग सुख देयर इज नो अटैचमेंट और डिजायर दैट अराइजेस. So what does this essentially indicate? The yogi is seeing the sukha and dukkha happening as a consequence of past action and the gunas acting. And because it is not giving rise to agitation or attachment, the karmashaya of the yogi is not increasing. And he is vita raga bhaya krodha. There is no fear or anxiety. There is no anger. There is no desire. And this is a sthita dihi. So essentially, the yogi rises beyond all of this because of the knowledge that he has. So this entire thing about that we have been seeing, the klesha moola karmashayaha and the avidya as the root of all other kleshas and so on, the whole point is to give rise to knowledge and then determine the mental attitude arising out of the wisdom, and then the actions of the yogi coming from that. There is also one interesting question asked in another test that says, okay, there is sukha and dukkha in everything. So then why is the yogi seeing everything as dukkha? Why not see everything as sukha? So firstly, the answer is, it is dukkha because from a yogi's point of view, it is unfavorable to his path towards apavarga because the karmashaya is increasing. But there is another point in the Vishnu Purana that says, all these sukha sadhanani and dukkha sadhanani, there is more dukkha than sukha from them. So there's a nice couple of lines in the Vishnu Purana that says, kalatra mitra putrartha grahakshetra dhanadikaihi kriyatena tata bhuri sukham pumsam yatha sukham. So the spouse, friend, child, money, house, field and land, dhanam, money, etc. Kalatra mitra putra artha graha kshetra dhanadikaihi kriyatena tatha bhuri sukham pumsam yatha asukham. All of this gives rise to a lot of sukha and dukkha, but there is not as much sukha as there is asukha from all these things. So that is a nice illustration from a very worldly sort of a example. And then one who notices all of this then is able to cultivate the right mindset, which also the Bhagavad Gita goes through in a very poetic and detailed fashion. So essentially, after describing the parinama dukkha, tapa dukkha and samskara dukkha, in a very nice line, Vyasa says, evam idam anadi dukkha sroto viprasrutam yoginam eva pratikulatmakatvat udvejayati. And now he will describe this with even more detail and in very impactful lines coming forward.
So this is the third kind of dukkha called samskara dukkha. The first one, paranama dukkha, effective, consequential sorrow in pleasure. Then tapa dukkha, the anxiety kind of torment in even pleasure consumption, pleasure, the gratification out of pleasures. Now the third one is samskara dukkha. This is the memory and samskara aspects. Whether it is painful experience or pleasurable experience, they get into the memory for all biological creatures. And then it is superlative in human beings that they all seep into memory and they manifest in memory. And then later they go into even samskara cortex. The simple meaning of the samskara dukkha is that we start developing habituation. In case of pleasures, when we have pleasure, the gratification of senses and pleasurable experiences, we don't just end up with consuming pleasure, having pleasure, but then we develop habituation. Why this habituation? That means it goes into memory, it goes into impression cortex, and therefore we will be recalling the pleasure often and often, will be wanting the pleasure often and often throughout the life and even perhaps after the life, end of the life also. There is so much of gravity of samskars is there that the pleasure seeking tendency doesn't even end at the point of death. It will get into samskar cortex and it will have the craze for the same pleasures. So this is with reference to samskars. Now, for common man, this is not a problem. Only habituation is a problem, that we get habituated to pleasures. Then if we don't get the pleasures often, then the sorrow is unnecessarily coming just because we did not get pleasure. Not having pleasure itself becomes significant sorrow. Not having pleasure should not be a sorrow if you think little more rationally. But then rationality goes into oblivion because of the samskar havoc and memory havoc. So that's the kind of habituation is developed. This is true to all biological creatures, that they start developing the habituation. Once you give the pleasure to them, they start developing habituation, and then it is superlative to mankind. It goes deep into samskar cortex. Then what happens, samskar cortex? Suppose you have a pleasurable experience, you want it more often, you want it in greater degree, etc., etc. So you get engaged into some kind of act which will help you regain the pleasure or re-procure the same pleasure. So we end up in getting some activity which is either of the nature of dharma and adharma. We will either commit virtue or even vice to have the same pleasure time and again. Second time, third time, and time and again. So we get into karmas which are either virtuous or vicious. Now, virtuous karmas are going to give pleasure, and vicious are going to give sorrow, which we saw in the last sutra. And therefore, we will be again getting qualified to experience the fruits, because we will commit karmas to get the pleasures. So we will create dharma dharma, which will be papa punya, and therefore there will be sukha dukha coming out of it. In case of sorrowful experience, in case of painful experience, again it will get into the memory. We will not forget, and then we will be again taking precaution, and we will be trying to avoid the pain coming once again and time and again. So again, or we do some preventive acts, we again get engaged into some karmas which are either virtuous karmas or vicious karmas. We can sometimes commit even virtue because of sorrow and to prevent the sorrow, the reappearance of sorrow. For that sake, we might commit even punya. But the punya has a fruit again. Or we might commit a papa, virtue, vice. And therefore, we will be again inviting some sorrow in our life. The point is, it goes to samskar kosha. When it goes to samskar cortex, then this wheel gets operated. Karma, karma phala, karma, karma phala, karma, karma phala. Now, this is not a problem to a materialistic man. He will be relentlessly trying to turn the wheel. But for a yogi who is wanting to escape from the wheel rotation or get out of the wheel, it is a greater concern for him. The samskar aspect, samskara dukkha aspect, is of greater concern for a yogi. But even for a little wiser man, he will know that I get habituated to it, and then I will be having demands, and therefore I will be trying to frantically go after doing some acts and earn my pleasures, prevent my sorrows, etc. So I will get engaged into some activities which are either virtuous or vicious, dharma or adharma, therefore papa or punya, and therefore sukha or dukkha. Sukha dukkha again gives the karma phala. And therefore, a little wiser man also reforms. He says, no, let me not, because then it is rotating me in the wheel more and more often. So for a wise man also, it will be a problem. Samskara dukkha will be identified. So this is dukkha by habituation and dukkha by creating impressions. See, these samskars are such things. See, if the parents have scolded a child, a tender age child will forget perhaps in matter of hours, matter of minutes even. Child will forget, although the child might have cried when it was being scolded. But if you and me are scolded, we will not forget for lifetime. That bitterness goes so deeper into our psyche that we will not forget for a lifetime. But the child forgets in a couple of minutes or perhaps even a couple of hours. Because its sorrows do not get into the samskara kosha so easily. Because it doesn't have all those gravities working so strongly as much as they work for we adults. So unnecessarily, somebody having scolded us, we will be for lifelong consider that person as enemy, get away from the person, avoid the person, or do some untoward thing for that person. So that's how there is harm, because we have a samskar cortex. The experience can quickly seep into samskar cortex. It is very difficult, impossible to prevent it. And therefore, the consequence of it is that we are going to get entangled into the wheel of karma, karma, phala, karma, karma, phala. That is the samskar. So it is a greater agony for a yogi. Why? It will be explained subsequently. But even for a wise man, he identifies, and therefore he is more rational, and he tries to reform. He identifies this, being little wiser. No, it gives pleasure, but I should be quite conservative here, not so liberal in taking the pleasures. I must reform myself. I must get away from this pleasure-seeking tendency also. It creates a problem. So, there is, because of this memory aspect, the memory aspects work that way. It goes into samskar. So, that is samskar dukkha. Okay.
Okay. So, at this point, I think let us stop here. The next some lines from Vyasa are very interesting and very impactful. And let us give it enough time and take it up in the next session. So let's chant the shlokas on Guruji and stop for today. Vaijnanikam pravaktritva asaneshu kalavidam yogabhyase cha tattvajnam vandeham sundaram gurum yogavrukshyo hi lokesmin yat prerenena vardhitah yogacharya guru tubhyam sundaraya namo namaha. Thank you.
Thank you. Namaskar all of you.